You've been branded with fire. It's the people who build their lives on the revelation of who Jesus is that will stand strong in every season. When you're born again into God's family, you've been born again with purpose to seek and save the lost, to disciple nations, to raise up, empower, and release the kingdom of God through His church. Declare His glory among the nations. Declare the possibilities and the greatness of God. To empower generations, to win generations. You're not here for you, you're here for the generations to come. If God be for you, then who can be against you? Now go change the world.
Patient and affliction and faithful in prayer. right, will you bow your heads and pray with me? Dear God, we just thank you for this time of gathering, of fellowship, of worship, and just lifting your name high, God. I pray that you just fill this place with your Holy Spirit, with your love, that you shower down your love on us, and that our hearts are just overjoyed to be in your presence. I want to lift up to you Gene Timms and Melvin Stanley and others in the church that are going through tough times, God, that you just comfort them, that you teach the church how to comfort them, that we can just be a shelter for each other and that we take shelter in you. God, I pray that the rest of this service is just pointed towards you and that our eyes are gazed upon your beauty. Just thank you for all that you do and all that you continue to do in our lives. Amen.
Down the Lord's time. chosen for the communion being today is a familiar one, one you've heard before. But I want to focus on the last few words of it. You'll recognize it. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. On the night when he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he also took the cup and said, "This cup is the new covenant established by my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Until he comes. Until he comes. Is today that day? Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you. And those words seem so little to say, but thank you for sending your son. Died on the cross for me, my family, my church family. You gave everything you have that we might gain everything you have in fellowship with the Father. Thank you for that. In Jesus' name, amen.
Jesus, thank you. How you're so good. Thank you for how you gave everything, Jesus. Thank you for how you're worthy of all praise, all honor, all glory, Jesus. I pray that your Holy Spirit would be welcomed here. Just pray that you'd lead us to give, God, with our whole hearts, Jesus. Pray that joy would come, Jesus. That you would move. And I pray that in Jesus' name. Amen.
As we begin a time of study here this morning, I want you to bow your heads and we'll pray together and prepare our hearts and minds for worship. Father, as we bow in worship to you, we bow our heads in recognition of who you are and in the truth of who you are, the beauty of who you are. We thank you for creating life and giving us life in this world, in this universe. Lord, help us to center our eyes, our hearts on you, to look to you for truth and answers. Thank you, Jesus, for dying for us, for giving us new life, for paying that price. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for leading and guiding the council. And Lord, I ask you now that you would open our eyes, our hearts to hear, to listen, to worship, and to understand your truth. We want to be your servants, and we want to shine your light in this world. It's in your name, Almighty Lord Jesus, that we pray. Amen. How many in this room have been pregnant? I'm not raising my hand. There's a lot of you ladies that have been pregnant. Did any of you ever get any advice while you were pregnant? Yeah, you know, the reason I ask that question is because, and it's like anything else in life, you get so much advice from all over the place, especially you females know that when being pregnant, you get all kinds of advice. Any of you ever get bad advice? You know, ever get that advice that you're like, no way am I doing that. Get away from me. Don't touch me. You know, that sort of thing. As we study this morning, we're going to be looking at this rich man that comes to Jesus and asks this simple question. The question's here on the screen. What must I do to inherit eternal life? I'm here to tell you, and you guys already realize it, but there are thousands upon thousands of advice and answers to that question in this world today, but there's only one that's right. And I'm here to tell you, there's only one that can tell you that answer, and it's one that came from there. And if they didn't come from there, then don't listen. I remember one time I was getting ready for, I think it was our third trip over to Tanzania. And somebody had asked a question, and somebody jumped in. You guys know folks like that that just jump in with the answers real quick? You guys know people like that? They know it all. So it wasn't here at church, let me just make that clear. But it was somewhere here in the community, and somebody jumps in with the answer and just starts talking about it. They've never been there, never been in the situation, but they're just telling these people, here's how it is, and this is what it is, and all that sort of thing. They didn't know I'd been there. And so I just sat back and listened for a while, and after it was all done, I said, okay, now that you're done with all that advice, here's what it's really like. You know, this is what it really is. From someone who's been there. What advice are you going to take? Are you going to take the advice of someone who's been there? Or someone who thinks they know all about there? Well, of course, we're going to take the advice of someone who's been there. We're also going to take the advice of that person how to get there. So as we look at these verses, I want you to have that mindset. We're looking at Mark chapter 10, starting with verse 17 and then down through the end of that, verse 31. So flip over your Bibles and take a look. The very first verse of this, we talk about that question. What must I do to inherit eternal life? That is the big question. You know, Scripture talks about all these different things, especially in the New Testament, that who's going to be in heaven? Well, we're going to look at that question today, but the one that's probably bigger to that is who's not going to be in heaven? And you guys know the laundry list? I mean, it basically says anyone who's immoral, and what falls into immoral? Well, anyone who lies, anyone who steals, anyone who's been sexually immoral, anyone that does any of these kind of things are not going to be in heaven. Well, what's that sound like for us? Yeah, we're all in trouble. I don't see anybody in this room that's not in trouble, and that's the bottom line of it. Scripture teaches that all men have sinned and fall short. Every one of us have baggage sitting here in this house today. And when it comes to this question, it should be a really big question, not just for people not in church today, but for us sitting in this house today. And this is what leads into it. As Jesus started on his way, a man ran up to him and fell on his knees before him. And he said, "Good teacher," he asked, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" As I read through the different accounts of this, I picture this man to be a really, really good guy. You guys know really good people around you? good guys, good women, a really, really good person. But there's something that Jesus is going to highlight that points out that sometimes when we think we know all the answers or we've got it all together, maybe we don't. And so as we go on down through the verses, we're going to take a look at that. Verse 18 and 19. Jesus asked this question in these verses: what is the definition of good? I think I've shared this one here before. How many of you ever heard somebody come up and say to you, "I have a good idea"? Anybody ever hear that? Maybe in church here. "I've got a good idea." Who determines what a good idea is? Because I've heard that phrase used many a time, and the idea that came out next was not a good idea. Jesus asked this question. This is how he says it. "Why do you call me good?" Jesus answered. "No one is good except God alone." And before we jump into verse 19, I want you to understand what Jesus is saying. The man that comes up to him says, "Good teacher." Now Jesus uses that as a point to teach this young man who he's talking to. When we say, "Are you a good person?" You ever heard somebody say that? Are you a good person? Are you good people? How do we weigh that usually when we say a statement like that? Well, they don't do this or that. They go to church. They're good people. Usually our definition is by their actions. They're good. But when Jesus uses this definition, he asks, what is good? What is his reference? He's talking about righteousness, holiness. Good is... And if you want the real definition, listen close. Good is God. And that's what he says. God alone is good. This person just asked him the question and said, "Good teacher," he addresses Jesus. So what is Jesus saying of himself? Jesus is good because he is God. Jesus, God, the Holy Spirit are one and yet completely separate. And I know a lot of people have a really difficult time understanding that. But when we talk about the Trinity, we're not talking about three gods. We're talking about one God. Jesus here is using a moment, a very small moment, to identify to this young man, "I am God." So when you say good, that reference is about God. And then he goes in straight into the commandments. It says in verse 19, "You know the commandments." And you guys know these commandments? What do we often call these commandments that are listed here in verse 19? The Ten Commandments, the Big Ten, whatever you want to reference them. It says, "Do not murder, do not commit adultery, do not steal, do not give false testimony, do not defraud, honor your father and mother." Now, how many of you have kept all of those? What? We're going to read on here these verses. Look what this young man replies to it. He says, "Teacher," he declared, "all these I have kept since I was a boy." So what is this young man that's asking the question saying? Hey, I'm a good guy. I've done all of that. I haven't committed broken those commands. And what is he referencing? You guys all probably realize what he's referencing, don't you? I would say, and like I said in my own thought process, when we're talking about this young man, we're talking about somebody who's really good. They say the right things. They do the right things. They're helpful. They do good for their community. All this is a good guy. And when he's saying he hasn't broken any of these commands, I think he's literally saying, "I have not physically broken these commands." That's pretty amazing, right? Now, do we know if this guy is a sinner or not? Well, absolutely, he's a sinner. And we know that Jesus had explained in other places that to look upon a person in lust, to have hatred in your heart, to do these things are sin in themselves. So we know this man's a sinner. Look what this is followed with, verse 21. Jesus looked at him, and what does it say? And loved him. I almost think you could say there right after that, "in spite of him." Because Jesus knew the condition of this man, and he knew what this man was dealing with, and he knew what this man needed to do, even though the guy himself did not realize it. And Jesus loved him. That's why it says at the top there, the love of Jesus is greater than my sins. Do you know when it was, or do you know how it works in church when you come and you confess Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior and you give your life to Jesus? How does that work? Did Jesus die before knowing your condition? Did he die before you surrendered? Well, absolutely. We know that. But what do we have to do to get ready to come to Jesus? This is not a trick question. Yeah. You don't have to do anything. The condition you are in at this very moment to receive Jesus, you come forward and allow him to change you. You know, our mentality is, well, I need to stop doing this, I need to do this, I need to do this. We go through this laundry list in our minds of all the things I have to do in order to be with Jesus. No, Jesus wants us the way we are, and then he works in us to transform our lives, our minds, our hearts. So often we see the effectiveness of the church and the church as a whole in our country where that doesn't seem to be the case, and I think that has to do a lot with our mentality. That we're trying to make things right by our own power. Every one of you in this room should understand, we cannot do it. If we could do it, we wouldn't even need Jesus Christ. And do we need Jesus? Yes. Absolutely. Goes on, verse 21, the second part of it. And I put up here in the header of it, it's case by case. We're not simply a number to God. You know, how many of you have heard that phrase before? Well, in the church, you're just a number, or they just want your money, or some kind of phrase like that. You ever heard that? That shouldn't be the case, but I can guarantee you, with God, you are an individual. God knows you personally, and it is case by case. And how we highlight that is in these coming verses. Jesus said, one thing you lack. Go sell everything you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come follow me. So his response to this young man, this really good guy, when he tells him about the commandments, and the man says, yes, I've kept all those commandments. You still lack this one thing. Is this the same answer you think Jesus would have gave to every one of you sitting in this room? I would say this is a really big topic that affects every single one of us in this room. But I think it's a case-by-case situation. God knows exactly what every single one of you in this room is dealing with. God knows what temptation that you struggle with the most in your own personal walk. God knows exactly what you're dealing with. It even goes on in Scripture, said in 1 Corinthians 10:13, that no temptation has seized you except that which is common to man. But God is able, and he will keep you from that temptation, or he'll provide a way out from that temptation. What does that mean to you? It means that God knows you so personally in this place that if you deal with the same thing this man dealt with, he would talk to you this way. But if it's dealing with something else, if it's kleptomania, then he would deal with you in that. If it's sexual sin, he would deal with you in that. Whatever the case is, whether it's gossip or something of that nature, that would have been the phrase that would have been filled in here. I want you to understand, God does not see you as a number. God sees you as a loved child. And for us to simply understand in this room, because a lot of you raised your hand earlier and said that you've been pregnant. If you've got kids, are your kids a number? Do you look at your kids and go, well, there's number two, there's number three, and you don't even reference them by a name? Surely not. You love them and you care about them as individuals. The same is true of God to us. In verse 22 through 26, so we jump into what this man's particular problem is. I want you to understand, again, this is what this man is facing. I know a lot of us in this room face it as well. Verse 22, at this the man's face fell. He went away sad because he had great wealth. Jesus looked around and said to his disciple, how hard it is for the rich man, for the rich to enter the kingdom of God. The disciples were amazed at these words, but Jesus said again,
children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter through the kingdom of God. The disciples were even more amazed and said to each other, before we go on there, I want to stop right there. As we look at those, that reference, how difficult did he say it was for a rich person to enter the kingdom of God? What does it say? Yeah, it's harder for a camel to pass through the eye of a needle. When you think of an eye of a needle, what do you think of? Okay, so most of us think of that sewing needle. We think of a camel trying to pass through that. That's pretty difficult. I want you to understand, when we hear this reference as a particular picture that Jesus is making of something that's very common to these people. And what the issue was, there was a gate to the temple, and they would call that temple the eye of the needle, that gate. The reason that was put in is because over the years, and this is what I've heard and read as I've gone through this, over the years, when men were going out to war and they were getting ready to fight their battles, they would come to the temple to have the priest bless them before they went out to battle. So they would ride up to the temple, they would get off their horses, they would get off their camels, they would go into the temple, they would have the priest bless them, and then they would ride off to war. Over the years, what had taken place there at the temple was that some of those men had become so impatient or had become so full of themselves that they would ride their horses or their camels right into the temple. Very disrespectful. And so they built a gate or a very thin entrance that only a man could pass through to keep them from riding their horses or their camels into the temple so that they could be blessed before they went to battle. So if a camel, here's where we go, if a man was riding a camel and didn't want to get off his camel to go into the temple, he would literally have to get his camel to sit down and to crawl through that gate or through that entrance. So that's where the reference comes from. We're not talking about chopping up a camel, making it into thread, and trying to pass it through the needle. We're talking about an issue of heart and soul. And I hope most of you guys understand this. When we join here, we're not here to practice some kind of religion. We're here to participate in a relationship with Jesus Christ. And there is a massive difference. There are so many people that go to church Sunday after Sunday to practice a religion. We're not here to practice. We're here to worship with Jesus Christ in a relationship that only He established and only He can sustain. But we are an active part in that relationship with Him. So we read through that. Does that help your understanding of that? Materialism is a big issue that is faced here. I've heard a Christian speaker say once before that he wished that his sons dealt with issues of sexuality, issues of theft, issues of whatever it may be, more so than materialism, because in our culture, we have all these things that we list off as sins, but when we say materialism, how many of you in this room go, oh, that's a terrible sin? Do any of you guys think materialism is an absolute terrible sin? You should raise your hands.
No.
Every sin is terrible. Every sin separates. Every sin takes us apart from God. Materialism, next to murder, guess what? It's still sin. Now, all of you in this room, if I said somebody murdered someone, you'd be aghast at it. But if we say materialism, it's like, oh, whatever. We need to recognize the sins that are in our life. Here's what I want you to understand from that as well. So often we walk into church and we think we already know all the answers. So often we come to this place and we think we already got it all together. This man that asked this question of Jesus Christ, he wasn't asking the question because he really wanted to know. In my own mind, I think he was asking the question to say, look, Jesus, look, God, I've kept all these commands. I'm a good man. I know I'm ready for heaven. What did Jesus say?
No.
This materialism in your heart, what you're all about, this is holding you back from the kingdom of God. Now we go into this last part, verse 27 through 31. The question is, who then can be saved? If this really good guy that did everything right wasn't saved, then who of you sitting here can be saved? Who of you here can inherit eternal life? When we go through that list, that is the right answer. All of us can. But as we read down through it, this is what Jesus said. Jesus looked at them and said, with man, and we hear this phrase all the time, this is impossible, but not with God. All things are possible with God. There's no one too far gone. There's no one who walks into this church building. There's no one in this community that is not possible. With God, all things are possible. Verse 28, Peter said to him, we've left everything to follow you. You guys remember what Peter left? He left his family. He left his dad. He left his fishing boats. He left his work. He left his house, all this, to follow after Jesus. Jesus said, I tell you the truth, no one who has left home or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or fields for me and the gospel will fail to receive 100 times as much in this present age. And then he paraphrased, homes, brothers, sisters, mothers, children, and fields with them, persecutions, and in this age to come, eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and the last will be first. As we read down through that then, the big question, who can inherit eternal life? Who can be saved? All of us. And, understanding, none of us unless Jesus Christ. So as we started off at the beginning of this message today, you're going to receive all kinds of advice over your lives. What eternity looks like. What happens after you die. What is the right answer. Which religion has it right. Let me tell you. Only listen to the one that came from heaven. Who's that? The Son of God. Jesus Christ. None other. I've said this many times over. But Christianity, the following after Jesus Christ, is the most inclusive of all the religions of the world, of all that we talk about, it's the most inclusive because Jesus Christ died for all people, all places, all time. But it's the most exclusive as well. And you know what I mean by that?
Yeah.
It's only Jesus. So if you hear somebody say, oh, surely that can't be. There's many paths, there's many ways. That's not true. It's a flat out lie. Jesus Christ is the only way. John 3:16, you guys know it. For God so loved the world so much, he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him will not perish, but will have eternal life. That is the promise. I encourage you this morning, your son, your daughter, your grandchildren, your nephews, your nieces, your neighbors, your co-workers, the people that absolutely frustrate the snot out of you, all of them desperately need Jesus Christ. And most of those people may never see Jesus except in you. So what Jesus do they know? We are called to be his hands and feet and to live in such a way to show that. So this last question, who can inherit eternal life? You guys know the answer to that? You can. But as you know, it's an individual basis. Remember what we said? It's case by case. You're not just a number to God. So when it's time, that last day, the final hour, that moment, God's judging us all, looking at us. Is it going to be, well, this group here, you're all over here. This group here, you're all over here. No, it's case by case, man by man, woman by woman. Every single one of us will have to give an individual account. The faith of your mom, your dad, this church, will not save you. It's your faith in Jesus Christ that saves. Do you understand that this morning? I have a fear that some of you walk into this room today and you think you have all the answers. Will you be like this rich young man that comes before Jesus and asks this question, and Jesus says you still lack this one thing? I don't want any of you to be lacking. I don't want any of you to be weighed on the scales and found lacking. The only thing that can take care of that is your 100% whole heart, mind, soul surrenderance to Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Would you bow your heads? Father, as we have read through your word, as we look at your beauty, at your glory, at your just extreme wisdom and guidance, Jesus being the one that has come from heaven, help us to listen to you, to your words, to your truth, to your teaching. Lord, I pray that you open our eyes, our ears, our hearts. Help us understand. If we come this morning with things in us that are holding us back, help us to lay those before you here at the cross, to surrender our lives, to surrender our families, to surrender our resources to your glory and honor, Jesus Christ. You're the Almighty. You're the only one that can save. It is you, Jesus Christ, that we pray and ask these things. Amen. Please stand as our praise team leads us in a time of decision. If you need to accept Jesus Christ this morning, confess him, I'd encourage you to step out in faith and to do that this morning.
Jeff Reed in your prayers this week, as he flies out to Tanzania tomorrow, right?
Yep. So,
and keep him in prayers for that. Soup Kitchen is the next one. It's January 22nd. There is a sign up out there on the bulletin board. We also still need some workers, some service there. If you could be a part of that, see Randy or Melinda. They can tell you which team and the dates and kind of the things that are involved in that. Out there on the foyer table, just before you go out the front doors, there is a 2018 giving statement sign up. If you'd like to have a statement of your giving for 2018, you can sign up for that sheet. Also, still opportunities to sign up for our coffee cafe to bring treats for that. What's the other one out there? My mind went blank. Just check the bulletin board. There's all kinds of things. So they have one. That's right. Out there. Yes. Okay, for Diane, for Amara. Okay. And we also want to thank Shane for helping us out today. And we might put him on a prayer list too. And if you know Shane, Shane has twins, and he has another set of twins on the way. Or maybe that's a praise. That's a praise.
Let's pray. Father, we do thank you for bringing us together for this time here to worship you. Lord, we do just want to lift up to you the requests that have been made. And for Diane tomorrow, as she has these tubes put in, I pray your hand of blessing. For Jeff, as he travels today over to St. Louis and then flies out to Tanzania tomorrow, I pray that you would just keep him safe, use him in a mighty way for your glory, and Lord, bring us success with this water well and the drilling of that for this community. Lord, I do just lift it to you, all those that are suffering in the family. I pray for your strength, for your healing, for your touch, and help us to minister and to show that love. Again, Father, thank you for salvation that comes through you alone, Jesus. Help us to just continue to plant those seeds and to tell others about that love and grace that you have given. It's in your almighty name, Jesus, we pray. Amen.